Hi, this is Ericka Chickowski here at the RSA Conference. I'm here today with Scott Borg, who is the director of the U.S. Cyber Consequences Unit. And we're talking a little bit today about security metrics, because that's what Scott is doing to talk about. So, Scott, some people might say security metrics are hard, if not impossible. Can you tell me a little bit about what it is that makes it easier for security people to measure what they're doing?
So security metrics aren't nearly as hard as people think. They seem hard because there's a lot of confusion about them, and we haven't been doing this long enough, so we've got set ways of doing things. Security metrics are incredibly useful because they give you some sense of whether you're accomplishing anything, whether you're doing the right thing, whether you're moving the right direction, if they're good security metrics, if they're the right kind of security metrics.
Right. What would you say are the right kind?
There's ultimately only one metric that everything needs to feed into or aim for, and that's risk. You need to know what your risk is. You need to know, and risk means what your likely losses are going to be in a given interval of time. So even though it might not be measured in money, it could be in lives or equipment, and even though the number might need to be very rough to be a credible number, you still need ultimately to get some idea of what your likely losses will be under different conditions. So ideally, a risk should be expressed as an annualized expected loss estimate.
Right.
And you want that to go down. And nothing else about your job as a security person actually matters except your ability to bring that number down.
And it seems like that is so completely tied in with business value. So how do you do that, especially as a security person who might come from a more of a technical background? How do they start learning how to tie that to business value?
So the single most important thing a security professional needs to know is where their business creates value, how their business creates value, and then incidentally, where their business could be caused the greatest liabilities. Businesses don't create value all over the place. There are usually a few areas that provide them with their competitive advantage, a few areas that are responsible for all of their profit. And then there are other things they do that really don't matter all that much. And those few areas that where a company has a competitive advantage are the ones an attacker wants to go after, because that's the vital information. Those are the key designs. Those are the customer records that are precious. Those are the things that are really going to be attacked, as well as the things you most need to protect. So the first thing a security person needs to do to make their work relevant from a business standpoint is to figure out where those things are, figure out what the systems are doing that
right.
we're protecting.
So you said, okay, there's only one real measurable that really matters, which is risk. Maybe we can talk about some sub-measurables, right? Can you name three of the most important measurables in your mind that a CISO should be communicating?
So ultimately, it comes down to risk. But there are other things, by the way, that are very useful. And it's difficult because most cybersecurity people don't know where their business, where their organization creates value. They can't figure out consequences very well, which you need to know for risk. And they're not usually collecting enough information about the attackers, about who's out there and how they can profit and what's happening to their business models. So it's very hard for them to do threats properly. So really coming up with a good risk estimate, is beyond the scope that's allowed for
right.
most cybersecurity people. Most cybersecurity aren't really given enough scope and authority to mm-hmm. do their job right. In the meantime, then, there's some other things that are very useful. The most useful other number is attacker costs.
Okay.
You want to employ security measures that will increase attacker costs. And a good rough estimate of how well you're doing is how much you're increasing attacker costs. Now, again, attacker costs don't have to be measured in dollars. In fact, usually the best way to measure attacker costs is the level of expertise required.
Right.
And the number of hours or days or weeks that an attacker would have to apply that level of expertise in order to succeed in the attack. There are always opportunities for making attacker costs a lot greater.
Mm-hmm.
And that gives you a goal that you can aim for that's not unreachable. You can't stop attackers, all attackers all
right.
the time, but you can up their costs. And even if you're up against the People's Liberation Army, They don't have an unlimited budget. I read people, they say, you know, unlimited resources. If you an ordinary mid-sized business can easily increase tax costs by a factor of 10 and often by a factor of 100. Even the People's Liberation Army can't expand their budget by 10 times or 100 times.
Right.
So tacker costs are extremely useful. And if you can make the costs greater than the gains, you've won absolutely. There's no reason to carry out the attack. If you can make the cost-gains equation for your organization worse for from an attacker standpoint, if you can make it worse than attacking other organizations, then you've won relative terms. So tacker costs is extremely useful. It's not as good as risk.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can increase costs for an attack that nobody's ever going to want to carry out and waste a lot of time doing that. But short of having a risk estimate, attacker costs is the next best thing.
Excellent. Great. Well, thanks so much, Scott, and I hope you enjoy the show.
Thank you.
Thanks.